That was weird. Weird. I don't know what that was. Okay. So, we're going to do some recording today. Let's see. We did Grand Theft Starship. So yeah, Crashing Through the Snow. That's this one now. Hello. Good morning. I am giving you audio to edit, sir. Check, check. Check, check. Check out my melody. Check, 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 check out my melody. If anyone knows what that reference is, you're old. All right, bye. Why are things? Check out my melody. Do we have rules about language? I mean, in what way? Because, like, you could say whatever the fuck you want for the most part. Just, you know, be a decent human being. That's pretty much my only rule, is don't be a piece of shit. Like, but no, there's no, like, language filters as far as I'm aware. I'm old. I will be 35 this year, and I will have my baby boy will be born either right before or right after my birthday, apparently. So that's pretty cool. That's fine. I mean, if there are multiple people who speak the same language that isn't English, feel free. Like, I don't care. I'm not so what's the word? Insecure that I'm worried about what people are saying in another language. Okay, it's not working and it's making me mad. I have to close this. No, don't save the project. Open it again. There you go. Yes, you are old too. Well done. Congrats if you really made it to 63. That's a life well lived. Excellent job. I hope to one day be double your age when all the robot parts are worked out. They're not, like, doing shit we don't want them to do, you know? Like, after the AI uprising has been quelled. Okay.
A couple things I need to do. Turn this off. So he's 100% selling this motherfucker.
My boss, my big boss, the owner of my company, felt the need to say that he's not selling and he's not, I don't know, lots of stuff. Anyway, interesting. Check, check 1, 2. Check, check 1, 2. There we go. Oh, and my wife's birthday is right after mine. So the baby's going to be born either right before both of our birthdays or in between them, which is pretty fun. All right, here we go. Salvage. A story by user... I'm an idiot. I know who this is. Rantarian. Yeah. Let's try that again. Salvage. A story by user Rantarian. Chapter 73. Crashing Through the Snow. Date point. 3 years, 8 months, 2 weeks, and 5 days after Vancouver. Dirktha. Largest city in all of Vaz. Kavorleche had always loved the night sky. As a boy, he had lain beneath it, within running distance of the tunnels, of course, and had imagined connecting the brightest of stars into a series of lines which, with a bit of creativity... Where's my clicky? Clicky? You should be, like, right here. There you are. And had imagined connecting the brightest of stars into a series of lines, which, with a bit of creativity, became the characters in his stories. Mighty Mutheng, for instance, the slayer of the hated Fordithrai, and his companions Zervir and Helic. Even now, in his older years, he still distinctly remembered the stories he used to tell his younger siblings and cousins. And the love for the stars had spawned them. That was why he had, against the wishes of his parents, found employment as an astrologer and eventually gained the position of astrologer to the High Lord. His calling had required him to keep unusual hours as needed for his observations, and to stand outside for the majority of the night when the sky was clear. Many thought such a thing was dangerous, that the night belonged to evil. But Kavor enjoyed the silence, the calm and quiet. It simply seemed holier than unholy, no matter how you looked at it. Usually it was extremely boring as well, with nothing at all happening. Tonight, however, without the aid of any lenses, he had witnessed the flash of a star exploding in the heavens, exploding and then falling away to the west in a trail of fire. That was not the same as other falling stars. Those streaked across the heavens before vanishing in a flash, and if they struck... they did so with a cataclysmic boom. This falling star was entirely the wrong way around.
"Very strange,"
he said, noting it down onto his... He said, noting it down onto his... He said, noting it down onto his most current sheet of newly pressed paper.
"Almost certain to be a sign, or portent of some kind."
He flinched as a deep and resounding roar rolled in from the cursed mountains to the north, a sure sign that the Dark One, an evil god thing that made its home in that place, did not approve of whatever had just transpired. Kavor held his breath, waiting for whatever came next. Would the Dark One arise as it had in ages past, sweeping down upon the land and crushing or burning any unfortunate enough? Sweeping down upon the land and crushing or burning any unfortunate enough to be found above ground? It seemed unlikely. It had slept uneasily for centuries, after all. But when you considered the falling star...
"I must speak to the High Lord,"
he determined, packing his things away in a hurry.
"He must be made aware that there are great things afoot."
There was another rumble from the mountains, and this time it lasted far, far longer. There would be no way such a thing would go unnoticed in the underhalls, and Kavor's presence would be expected, along with a suitable explanation of what was happening and what was to come. He hurried a little more. It was best not to keep the High Lord waiting, and considered his words as he lumbered back towards the safety of the tunnels,
making his way through the carefully disguised entrance and into the true city that lay beyond. Dirktha was far and away the most glorious of the undercities in the known world, its halls having been designed and refined by the countless generations who had lived there, and the halls of the High Lord were the most ornate of them all. Gold and silver adorned intricately carved stone, and perfectly cut gems split the incandescent lights of the great hall. Those dim lights and the technology required to produce them were one of the few secrets of the ancients that had survived the coming of the Dark One and the long years thereafter. The High Lord, Zola Mun, sat atop his throne with as much regality as he could muster, looking remarkably stupid in the process. He was young and a poor imitation of his father, but he still put on the airs of greatness he had not earned. "Approach, Cavor," he commanded, waving his astrologer forward. When the court finally realized Cavor was there, they had been busy worrying about what the trembling had meant, had been postulating theories of all sorts, and now that Cavor finally arrived, they treated him with a deference normally far too absent. Cavor knew the situation was grim, but he enjoyed their suddenly respectful attitudes nonetheless. He walked along quietly, going at his own pace until he was suitably positioned before the throne, and then he gave the respectful grunts and squats as was customary. "My lord, I bring word from the surface."
"We want word of the Dark One, astrologer," High Lord Zola replied irritably, adopting the affectation of annoyance he assumed by habit whenever something unexpected occurred, or whenever he didn't understand something. Cavor suspected he thought it made him seem in control, when all it did was make him seem like a spoiled idiot. Nevertheless, Cavor played the politics, and it was a lot easier to win when your opponent was a buffoon.
"Of course, High Lord. I was intending to get to that. The Dark One rumbles more than he has in my lifetime, but it was only because of my other news that we can gain some insight into this."
This did not seem to please the High Lord, although remarkably little did if you didn't include idiotic babble and fucking everything he saw.
"Will the Dark One awaken?"
The entire hall held its breath, waiting for Cavor's answer. Now was his chance to deliver portent and information all at the same time, and in a way that would be impossible for the foolish boy to ignore.
"Without knowing the nature of the fallen star, it seems inevitable."
Uproar ensued, continuing some time in spite of High Lord Zola's insistent demands for silence. When he finally had it, he resumed his seat and tried not to look too terrified.
"This fallen star, what are you speaking of?"
Cavor bowed his head, as if he was lost in thought, and waited for the moment that the crowd was straining to hear his voice. Then, finally, he spoke.
"A flash in the sky lit the red horizon, and streaked with white fire to the west as though fleeing the Dark One, and finding safety on the ground. The Dark One howled when he realized his quarry had escaped him, and now threatens to rise once more to reclaim it."
"What is it?" hissed the High Lord, captivated. "Some weapon we could use against the Dark One?"
Cavor had no idea, but ignorance wasn't any reason to forgo a good story.
"Perhaps. It is a thing of mystery, High Lord, and demands an investigation before the Dark One can hide it away once more. Perhaps it could even be the Chosen One."
Again, the hall was plunged into a chaos of competing conversations, although far more muted than before given the subject at hand. The Chosen One, a story passed down from generation to generation, was the promised savior of their beloved world. The Chosen One would deliver them from the evil of the Dark One and restore the people to the surface of their world. Besides the accursed creature itself, the Chosen One was the nearest thing they had to a religion. The High Lord rose, shouting for silence once more. But this time he remained standing when his will was finally observed and obeyed.
"It shall be so, then. The astrologer, along with two other elders and their entourage, will travel west to where this fallen star now rests. I require the blades of those brave enough to make the overland journey and risk their fate at the predations of the Dark One."
The hall was silent as those present looked between each other. none of them willing to be the first to embark upon the suicide mission. Cavour, for his part, was staring around in shock and terror, and would have preferred to send someone younger and more expendable in his stead.
"Cowards!" the High Lord growled, accusing them all somewhat hypocritically. "Very well. I shall reward those of you who go with riches, and should you fall in the light of duty, your families will enjoy the spoils instead."
A far better arrangement, as far as anybody could be concerned, Cavour thought. Not that it helped him in any way, shape, or form. He'd rather be poor and alive than rich and dead, and no doubt most others would agree. So that meant he'd be traveling with a pack of idiots and mercenaries.
"I shall go," the
young Lord Grotti declared, stepping forth from the crowd and proving Cavour's suspicions entirely correct in regards to the latter possibility.
"I shall protect you and your noble quest."
"I shall protect you and your noble quest, astrologer." Young Lords Vidae and Iravir soon joined him, and that meant an entourage of significant size. Three lords had volunteered, but their own men would enjoy no luxury of choice than Cavour himself. But their own men would enjoy no more luxury of choice than Cavour himself had. That was fine. He'd have someone to share his misery with.
"Who else shall you choose to bring with you, astrologer?"
the High Lord asked in a surprise move. At first, Cavour was so confused about the question that he had no idea what kind of answer to give.
"Who else?"
the High Lord smiled.
"The other elders. I did say there would be three."
Cavour had no idea. In his opinion, any elder would be as useless as another, with the exception of those too decrepit to move, and those he named would undoubtedly bear him a grudge for the rest of their lives. It was much better to have the idiot ruler making these kinds of decisions.
"Perhaps the High Lord could deem this old man worthy of guidance in this matter. I had thought someone spry, but beyond that my wisdom fails me."
The idiot was delighted to discover his wisdom being deferred to, and immediately began counting off those he thought worthy or otherwise, finally making the decision to send elders Tak and Borivud with him. Searching the crowd for their faces, Cavour was darkly amused to find the two adopting very obviously false expressions of happiness.
"That will teach you for laughing at me,"
Cavour muttered unkindly, recalling how they had all snickered as he had performed his noble profession in days gone by. If he was to be doomed, then at least he'd be taking a couple of them with him.
"Perfect,"
the High Lord decided, clasping his hands in a gesture of self-congratulations.
"Now, you must all prepare to depart as soon as possible. If this really is the Chosen One, I will not leave them to be hunted down and destroyed by the Dark One before they have a chance to strike."
"Yes, Grog. Me read good."
"Me like read. Want crush? Me crush now?"
"One moment, everyone. I must attend to something. I have to do what's called a deload week this week for lifting, which is where I don't lift very much at all. I lift like maybe 40% of what I'm capable of lifting or so, maybe less. And just sort of put it in maintenance so that I can recover. I'm really tired, and I still have to do that, though. So that's going to be fun to do that today. All right, let's see. Where were we? Right here. You go there. You go there. Clicky is here.
Record 573-black-08. Recovered from C11-orange-712-yellow-6.
"And it works!"
exclaimed the cheerful face that filled the camera's frame.
Looks like it's taken a few knocks.
What was he... What was he even doing with that thing?
Another voice, female, asked.
I've seen a lot of shit, but I never thought I'd kill a man who was pleasuring himself at the time.
Maybe there's something on here he thought was worth pleasuring himself too, the grinning male said.
Nah. The grinning male said, turning the camera towards a uniformed female with scarlet hair.
Not that I'd know anything about that sort of thing.
She rolled her eyes like she didn't believe him.
The man was killing people from up on his little hill. I might not be getting paid anymore, but I'm still law enforcement, and I don't need to know anything more about him than that.
Nice speech,
the male replied, causing her nose to blush.
Be quiet and see if he had anything useful on him, apart from that stupid toy, she ordered. Weapons and ammunition especially. Somebody has been going around burning people to death, and if we run across them, I'd like to give him the same treatment we gave Mr. Dyes while fucking his own hand here.
Yeah, no problem,
the male acknowledged, turning the camera towards the ground. End recording. Date point. 3 years, 8 months, 2 weeks, and 5 days after Vancouver. The Governess. Crash landed on C-11-Orange-712-Yellow-6. Jennifer Delaney. Mid-20s. Space babe adventurer and beginner mode survivalist, professional explorer and accidental bank robber, and most recently of all a castaway in uninhabited space. Things could be better. They could be worse as well. She still had power and heat, which was good considering the winter wonderland going on outside, and she had enough of a kinetic drive left working to make very short hops, not that she wanted to risk catching another of whatever had hit her in the first place.
How long can we stay here? Old Jen worried. Whatever attacked us might be on its way.
Jen assessed her situation, counting the assets available to her. Counting the assets available to her, should she decide to go play in the snow at night. Okay. Jen assessed her situation, counting the assets available to her, should she decide to go play in the snow at night. The risks involved in that particular adventure did not stack up against staying on the ship and simply monitoring the sensors for anything that approached.
Out there I have no information, no warmth, no proper lighting, and no power.
New Jen replied.
I'm staying put until there's a real danger.
She'd made a good argument, and old Jen was silenced by it. She used the time to take a proper look at the big fucking hole that had been punched in the engineering section and just the right spot to cut off all power to the main kinetic drive without destroying anything else around it. That meant it was repairable, but had that been by luck or by design? The latter possibility didn't do a bloody thing to ease her concerns. Still, that gave her a chance. She was smart. She had a stack of owner's manuals, and she knew enough not to stick the fork in the toaster without unplugging it first. She'd even packed a good bit of spare conduit, thanks to her experiences watching Adrian waste a small mountain of the stuff back on the Zadarsil. He would have been handy to have around. At least when he wasn't causing a disaster simply by existing in a given space. Actually, it would have been nice to have anyone around, now that she was getting to think about it.
It's okay, she told herself before she started having an anxiety attack. There are people here of some type.
Jesus, you scared the shit out of me, honey.
Didn't mean to scare you.
Hi, baby.
Something came up. I have to do some work.
Oh.
So you'll need to take a... recording break.
I have to take a recording break for a second.
For a
I gotta take a chat with my peeps for a little bit. Hi everyone, how are you? My wife has to work for a little bit, so I can't actually like record because she do typey things. She do lots of typey things. Oh. Hey up, love. Coke, if you want to sponsor me, I would be okay with that. You just got to give me a lifetime supply. Hello, St. Boulder. How are you? Hello, Scott. Horsefall. That's great. Inquisitor Yogg-Sothoth. No, I do apologize, buddy. I gotta just take a second. I do apologize. We'll play some
why don't we play some fun stuff in the meantime? Maybe we do a little... Yeah, let's do some Slay the Spire. Although I have been playing Stormgate lately. Oh, this game is so fun. I can't wait for the third race. I'm going to... don't worry. I will go right back to streaming as soon as she's done. I don't know how long that will take. Honey, do you have an ETA?
No.
No? No ETA.
You're still streaming. You're just not recording.
Sorry, back to recording. I said the wrong thing, okay? God. Do you see the abuse I suffer from, guys? Do you see this? So mean. You know I'm kidding, right? Okay. I got the moral of approval, so I should be okay. Let's turn the sound on. I've been playing the Silent trying to get it up to level 5 Ascension like these two are. I don't like the Watcher, so. What's up, baby?
We're talking.
Oh, I thought you said something.
I did, but it's work stuff.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
How often do you talk to yourself when you're working? A lot.
Let's just ask it.
So I don't have to do that?
No, I was just wondering. Let's see. 1, 2, 3. I can get to it. Oh, that's awesome. Okay. We'll do one here. And now we wait. And now we play the waiting game. I really like Sneaky Strike. That's a great one. But so are Caltrops and Bouncing Flask. Bouncing Flask is nice, especially if you upgrade it, because you do 12 poison instead of 9. That's pretty good. But Sneaky Strike, that extra econ is really nice. I think I'm going to do that. And we're just going to go up this way. Oh, come on. I wish you could sell stuff. I would sell something just to get that membership card. It's only 152. Ugh. Nah, we're going to get rid of a strike. Get rid of one strike. That'll be good. Proceed. Go through here. Well, good, Saint. I'm happy to hear it. I have been off dealing with the world and baby. I'm going to have a baby. So, mostly that and work. A lot of work. I like flechettes, but I don't really have what I need for that. I like Blur a lot. Like Piercing Whale. Let's do that. This is a fun game. Fuck. I screwed up. Yep, I screwed up. Dang it. Yes, that is true. Oops, I went the wrong way. Shoot. Well. Not really the way I meant to go. Yeah, that's awesome. Okay, cool. Oh, I got Gremlin Knob, 1 health. Dead. Oh, cool. Darkstone Periapt is good. Aiming for an X build, sort of. Yeah. I need to get back on Creature 88. That's a great series. No, I'm fine there. Yeah, I need to get back on Creature 88. I actually really enjoy that one, and it's got an ending, so I should probably, you know, do that. Bump 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 bump. Yeah, but this game's really fun. I like it a lot. Calculated Gamble is a great card for later in the game. We'll take it. All right, which way should I go? To the fiery boy? I have full health. I there's no reason not to. Let's drink that, and then we will... Yeah, let's do that. Let's injure him. And we'll just do that. And then we get to keep our extra 8. That's, you're not wrong. That's a very good point. I forgot where that exactly. I'll record some more 88 tonight. Or today, this afternoon, whatever. Well, that's not really what I wanted. That's not really what I wanted either. Should protect me mostly. Still gonna take 2 damage. I keep putting dazeds into my hand. I hate that. They are very useless cards, yeah? Screw this. Almost got him. Be able to kill him next turn, which will be great. Okay. Bum, bum. Bum, 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 bum. There's not really a reason to do that, but I did it. Bum, bum. Ugh. I take that 10 damage. Taking 22 damage this fight so far. Crazy today. It's all poofed up. Dead. Yeah, doesn't matter what I do. after that. And Gregor, sorry I didn't see your thing earlier. I will give you audio to edit. It is happening. Four damage, better than 10. Cool. Two blocks I don't need. At least I got rid of some dazed. And then got back almost as many, which is fun. This fight's such a slog sometimes. There we go. Perfect. Oh, cool. Two more defends I don't need. Lord have mercy. I have exhausted 1, 2, 3, 4, wow, 5, 10, 15, almost 20 dazed. Hi, baby. Are you finished? That was quick. You're amazing. Can I have kisses? Give me 2 seconds, guys. I have got to go get a bathroom break. I'll be right back. Thank you. finish this round and then we'll get back to recording. Sound good, everybody? That sucks. Oh no, I can kill him. Boop. I like Crippling Cloud. I like Quick Slash. I like Expertise. These are all good. I'm gonna go with Quick Slash. Okay. We are going to save and quit because I don't want to go through another fight. Okay.
Before she started having an anxiety attack. There are people here of some type. Jesus, you scared the shit out of me, honey.
Okay. My wife scared me so bad. You got stabbed in the fin- Did you- Was- For blood? Okay. See you, Grog. I didn't see that before. Okay. All right, where is... There we go.
There are people here of some type, so you're not entirely alone, even if they do want to kill you.
The threat of panic subsided slowly.
It's okay. It's okay. It's okay, she told herself.
Yeah, there we go.
It's okay,
she told herself before she even... She told herself before she started having an anxiety attack.
There are people here of some type, so you're not entirely alone, even if they do want to kill you.
The threat of panic subsided slowly, and once it was gone, or at least unlikely to rise in a hurry... She didn't feel like doing much except going to sleep. With that in mind, she set alerts to wake her should anything untoward occur, and nestled into the comfort of her seat to sleep until dawn. Hi, bub. It arrived to greet a purely overcast day, and Jen waited until she'd had a good breakfast and had done some preliminary study of the manuals before she'd rugged up and ventured out into the world beyond. Her first steps upon the alien world, although apparently not the first made by intelligent beings, still filled her with a rush of exhilaration as sharp as the bite of the cold mountain air. She'd packed her planetary sampling kit, determined that this would not be a simple walk to see the sights of the world that may well be her home for many years to come. If she couldn't leave, it was time to get to know it a little better.
Good air, she observed,
as the instruments measured it as nearly optimal for human habitation.
Background radiation very slightly elevated, but not to dangerous levels. No airborne microbiological hazards... Or at least not here. Looks good so far. Except for the people who tried to kill us,
old Jen reminded her.
As things go, that's quite the downside. I don't need to be told that,
new Jen replied, not rising to the fight. She still wanted old Jen gone, and that wouldn't happen unless she stopped having the conversations. Then she just had to get off world and get some company before she really did go mad. That was when she was pinged by her ship's automated sensors. Something was trying to get into the governess. She looked back at the way she came, judging it to be about 5 minutes of hard running before she could arrive.
Bloody fucking hell,
Anything could happen in that time. Not exactly what she expected to happen, though. She arrived, pushing her body to its limits against the Earth's standard gravity, and regretting the fact she hadn't bothered to exercise under its full strength during her journey, and saw her ship being lifted away into the sky under the power of some invisible force. "What the fuck?" she said, pulling out her data pad and taking remote control of her ship. "Oh no, that is not happening!" At her command, the governess sprang to life, lurching against what had grabbed it, and, with a clang of metal striking metal, revealing that it was nothing more than a cloaked vessel of some kind making off with her only means of transportation. The efforts of her starship were completely futile in comparison to those of the invisible vessel. However, and it soon became very obvious that not only was it happening, but that there was absolutely nothing she could currently do about it.
"I'm not sure what we did to deserve this sort of thing happening to us all the time,"
old Jen reflected, unbidden.
"Shut it,"
said New Jen sharply. Things weren't entirely screwed just yet, because she still had the data pad, and she still had her life. And as long as she had both of those, she'd be able to find the people who were trying to kill her and take all of her stuff and jam a lifetime of regret well and truly up their asses. No sooner had she decided that vengeance was definitely the course she wanted to take than did four... No sooner had she decided that vengeance was definitely the course she wanted to take than four small robots peeled away from the invisible ship above, dropping into the snow and resisting their impact with a sharp burst of kinetic force. They were crab-like things, no larger than the size of a small horse, but they each carried a plasma gun large enough to label them as psychotic killing machines rather than helpful maintenance bots. Jen stared at them a moment before they had a chance to become aware of her presence.
"That's just fucking great."
With no food, no shelter, and extremely stupidly, no gun of any kind, the choice was simple. It was time to start running again. Date point: 3 years, 8 months, 2 weeks, and 6 days after Vancouver. Vicinity of Dirktha, largest city in all of Vaz.
"There's no way it's natural for it to be this cold," Elder Borivud complained, drawing his heavy cloak more tightly against the fur of his body. Like Cavor, his family was of common stock, and the cloak was dyed in the drab, depressing colors that such families were limited to, a far cry from the vivid combination of hues that acted as the heraldry of Tak and the young lords.
Once upon a time, their people would have had little need for clothing to warm them against a light snowfall such as this. Their ancestors had been more heavily furred and better adapted for the vagaries of the surface world. But the long years underground had thinned their fur and any resistance to the extremes of temperature that could be found in the surface world.
"Don't be a child," Cavor snapped, irritated at the uselessness of the old man. "This is nothing compared to the coldest days of deep winter." "I've heard stories of men being frozen alive," Elder Tak noted sagely, spouting the usual nonsense that served to impress idiots who didn't know any better. "Can you imagine such a thing, young Lord Gruddy?"
"Such a thing is beyond my experience, Elder," Lord Gruddy replied politely, although it was clear to Cavor that he could not give a shit about anything the old man had to say. "I would have thought a man would die from the cold long before he actually began to freeze."
Not a complete idiot, Cavor was interested to observe. The young Lord Gruddy had not suggested such a thing because it was merely what he had assumed, but rather as a subtle barb to hint at the elder being a total nitwit, although that fact was self-evident as far as Cavor was concerned.
"You would think that," Tak said, "but there are stories of men frozen forever in ice but still in possession of their minds. You see, their bodies froze so quickly.
You see, their bodies froze so quickly that their very life was trapped inside, unable to escape.
Grotti glanced to Borivud to see him nodding along sagely, and then at Cavour, who most pointedly did not. Instead, the two of them shared a knowing look that told them something more of each other than they'd perhaps expected to find.
"And I imagine they're still there to this day," Cavour asked conversationally. "Trapped alive in the ice?"
"Oh, yes," Tak replied, "although the records are unclear as to where. It must be somewhere very cold for them to stay frozen during high summer, then," Cavour continued. "Otherwise your story wouldn't make any sort of sense, would it?"
"Of course it's somewhere cold all year around," Tak snapped, annoyed at the implication he didn't know what he was talking about. "Otherwise, they'd all just thaw out and die normally."
"Hold a moment," Grotti interrupted, quickly communicating with the other two young lords and drawing everybody into the cover afforded by the forest and the bleach-white sheets they carried as camouflage.
"What is it?"
Vorova demanded, looking around with his head exposed until he was forced back into hiding.
"Buzz in the air," Grotti hissed quiet.
"Just like the story said."
"The Dark One?"
Borivud asked in a more strangled tone.
"Here?"
The buzz became more prominent, sweeping over them from the east and giving no other sign of anything being out of the ordinary. They remained still until long after it had gone, waiting for it to return at any moment and put an end to all of them. Then, as they were about to continue, the buzzing began to return.
"It's coming back," Grotti noted.
"Stay perfectly still."
"If we stay, we die," young Lord Irivir countered. "I, for one, intend to live. Men, scatter!"
"Men, hold!"
Grotti snarled at his own men.
"Go and die, fool. We shall see who is right."
They stared at each other for a moment, hatred in their eyes, and then Irivir, along with his men, was gone. A blast wave of heat and several truncated screams of agony later, and it was clear who'd been correct in their exchange.
"Well," Grotti said, a little unsteadily, I suppose that proves the camouflage works."
"It was a good plan," Cavour said. "It is a pity that young Lord Irivir had to prove alternative courses of action so unwise. But now we know."
"Now we know," Elder Tak agreed. "Does this mean we go home? The Dark One must have finished his work."
Cavour growled, baring his teeth at the stupid old man.
"And then what? We wait for death? And if we press on, perhaps we can find some evidence as to what the Dark One found so interesting. The most likely thing we will find is our doom,"
Elder Tak shocked back.
"Just because you have nothing worth living for."
Cavour punched him in the face, drawing blood from his withered old snout and knocking him to the ground. Cavour followed him down, continuing his violence until Grotti and his men reluctantly pulled him away.
"And you three are supposed to be wise men?" he asked in disbelief. "Little wonder the kingdom has begun to decay."
Tak ignored the chastisement, staring with pure, undisguised hatred at Cavour.
"You will regret that, astrologer."
"Shut up," Grotti snarled. "You will both behave, or so help me, I will take the gifts and leave you all behind."
"What did I do?"
Borivud whined, then shrank before Grotti's glare.
"Fine."
Cavour did not shrink, but did at least reply with a curt nod. He would not be cowed by this would-be warrior, not with a simple glare at any rate. But for the time being, he would abide by the rules. He could enact a proper revenge later. There were many dangers on the surface world, after all, such as accidentally falling off a cliff, or being blinded by having your eyes stabbed out. All sorts of things. Young Lord Vede finished packing the camouflage back up and joined them at the head of the procession.
"What are we waiting for, Grotti?"
"Nothing further, Vede," Grotti said, giving one more warning glance to the three elders. "Ensure you do not break from the plan as Irivir did. I would not wish to lose you as well."
"I am not a headstrong idiot,"
Vede replied, "and I have the benefit of experience from his mistakes. I will be careful, but I will not flee."
"Gather the gifts,"
Grotti instructed, pointing to the carefully sealed packages. Take one for your group. I shall take the other. Do you want the furs or the gavazzi? Vede asked. I will be most displeased if you say the furs. Gavatsky is gavaxti vaga.
I said it really easily the first time. Gavaxti.
Gavaxi is a delicacy you should want to take, Grotti replied, although he didn't want it any more than Vede did, and Cavour didn't blame him. The mulled baby considered to be a delicacy, but that merely meant it was very expensive and rarely consumed. Those with more refined tastes made certain competitions about the tastes of various batches, but as far as Cavour was concerned, it tasted much the same as vomit. I'm not taking your foul-smelling ball of muck, Vede replied flatly. It was these elders who decided it was worth taking. Although why you'd want to make the chosen one your enemy, I've no idea. That had been Borovud's idea, along with the rest of the gift-giving process. He'd reasoned that everybody enjoyed receiving gifts, and apparently, since he actually enjoyed the disgusting tastes of Gavaxi, he had decided the chosen one would as well. Fine, Grotti said unhappily. Just get back into position so we can start moving again. There was a rumble from the mountains to the distant west, emanating from their presumed destination, a sound of shifting earth that gave them all pause. Grotti gave Cavour another look. You're sure? Cavour wasn't sure at all, but he wasn't going to let uncertainty and fear color his reputation any further than it might have done already. I am sure.
Oh! Oh, God, why? Oh, God! Ha! Oh, that would hurt. I'm so sorry, man. I'm so sorry. That sucks. Ugh.
Oh, no.
Planet Cisco, Alpine region. Planet Cisco, Alpine region of northern continent. Jennifer Delaney was, for want of a better term, snowboarding down the treacherous slope of the mountainside. Her board was a piece of hull debris that had been the closest thing to match a proper board, and her reason was the four very aggressive killer robots who were zipping down after her, assisted by their own kinetics. All of them were trying to outrun the avalanche. Being from Belfast and a not particularly adventurous family, Jen had never actually done any sort of skiing in her life, and even with the substantially improved reflexes and core body strength, she was having a difficult time of figuring it out. The problem was that she only really had the one shot at it, with any mistake leading to either being burned to death or buried in ice, or some horrible mix of the two. "Trees, rocks, poorly placed fucking shrubberies," she said, counting off the dangers that could immediately bring an end to her desperate bid to escape. She didn't even know how close the robots were behind her, or even if they still were. The roar of the avalanche was a thunder that engulfed the world around her, and she could only focus on the path directly ahead. And it did take all of her concentration. The landscape was flashing past so fast that she had to give all her attention to identifying each and every threat that lay ahead. Trying to plot a course between them that would require the fewest movements as possible. "Duck the branch," she instructed herself, carefully crouching into a balanced squat in order to avoid the thick branches of a particularly sturdy tree. Beep. A few heartbeats later, she heard the satisfying crash and noise of twisting metal that rose above the rumble of the landscape, informing her that a small victory had been won. That brought her down to 3 remaining robotic death machines, so it was still far too early to celebrate. "Rock!" she spotted, shifting to the side to slice left. She narrowly avoided a sharp rock protruding from the snow-covered terrain, but there was no follow-up explosion to indicate another small win. The next obstacle was less avoidable. The slope dropped away sharply, a drop of 50 feet or more into an older, thicker forest of conifer. No chance to stop.
The avalanche would get her if the robots didn't. No chance to drop, the fall would cripple her, and the robots and ice would do the rest.
This is a bad idea? This is a bad idea?
Old Jen exclaimed as they raced towards the edge.
Bad idea, bad idea, bad idea. Fuck!
New Jen screamed as she came to the end of the slope, as much in defiance as in raw terror. The momentum, in combination with her own sudden lunge towards the safety of the treetops, launched her out into the empty sky as the three remaining robots veered for safety, only to find the rush of ice and stone instead. Jen was left at the top of a tree, ignoring the painful prickle of the needles as she held on with all her might, and remaining there until the mountain finally grew quiet. Lost on a mountain, Jen was left at the top of a tree, ignoring the painful prickle of the needles as she held on with all her might, and remaining there until the mountain finally grew quiet. Lost on a mountain, marooned in space, and stuck at the top of a tree. All in all, today could have been a better day. At least she still had her teeth. The Mountains of Seard, 2 days west of Dirktha. Look up there, Grotti pointed out to Vidae. The mountain is crumbled as if from some great battle. Vidae looked in the direction and studied it well. It is clear of the heavy snow and ice the other peaks carry, he observed. The trees are all broken. Do you think the Chosen One was caught in such a thing? Vidae looked in the direction and studied it well. It is clear of the heavy snow and ice the other peaks carry, he observed. The trees are all broken. Do you think the Chosen One was caught in such a thing? Grotti thought the concept of the Chosen One to be a quaint story with a lot of wishful thinking. A story of hope best told to children. Hope was important, however, and he had not argued against it in others, no matter how fanciful their beliefs. If he was, I am sure he survived. Then the savior we seek must be somewhere around here, Vidae replied, looking around eagerly. Do you think he's big? The size of the Chosen One has nothing to do with his power, Elder Tak declared, joining them at their position atop the small ridge. He may be gigantic, or he may be as big as... He trailed off, pointing a finger at a slight movement in the distance. As whatever that thing is. Grotti followed the gesture to see the small biped that prowled the mound of debris. That it wore clothes was obvious, unless its fur was extremely well-tailored. But the only other observable facts were the hairless face and its non-membership in the Aguaran race. He dropped to the ground and ensured Tak and Vidae followed in suit. Do not allow it to see you, he told them. We have no idea what it is. We need to get a better look at it, said Vidae. It might be the Chosen One. Chosen One? Tak asked in disbelief. It isn't even a Gwaren, and it's so small. You just got through telling us that size meant nothing, Grotti observed. But Vidae is correct regardless of whether it is the Chosen One or not. We need a better view. Getting close may be dangerous, Tak warned. It is clearly not of this world. It may be a Krevu, such as those in mythology. They are harmless creatures in appearance, but will viciously tear the flesh from lone wanderers. A good thing we are not alone, then, Grotti remarked, wondering how this old man had achieved any kind of recognition. Simply being older than everyone else was no cause for giving respect. I was considering an alternative, however. I will keep watch. Vidae, go and find Cavor and get his lens. Tak, go back and get ready the gifts, just in case. He watched them go, making sure they weren't going to simply walk away and take a position somewhere else, and turned back to look at the strange biped picking debris from the pile. What are you? He whispered, watching the thing move around with otherworldly grace. He wondered whether anything that moved with such beauty could be an agent of evil. He supposed that they would have to see. Planet Sisko, alpine region of northern continent. Climbing down a wannabe conifer was about as pleasant as climbing down the real thing, with plenty of discomfort caused by taking hold of branches covered in needles, and despite it taking longer than she might have liked, Jen got to the bottom having only nearly killed herself twice. There was no sign of the deadly robots, which was either very good or very bad, depending on how optimistic you were feeling. Jen suspected they were all still buried under several tons of ice, rock, and other debris, but she wasn't about to make assumptions when the result of being wrong has... But she wasn't about to make assumptions when the result of being wrong was to be burned alive. That was why she had not simply run away in the hope that they wouldn't be able to find her. If she wanted to feel safe, she had to be sure that they weren't going to fight their way free and come after her. And that meant slowly picking over the debris with deliberate care.
"It doesn't look like anything could have survived this," old Jen observed, failing to be overwhelmingly negative for once. "But I don't think we should stick around, even if they are wrecked."
That was a sensible notion, New Jen thought. Any half-decent setup would soon realize that the killer robots had themselves been killed and would send others to come looking for those responsible. Jen didn't think she'd survive if that happened. She'd barely survived the first time, and figured her best bet was to hide rather than run. If she could find a suitable hidey hole close to the area, she might even be able to see whatever came searching the area. And if the robots did, by some small miracle, drag themselves out of this pile of debris, well, she'd see that too.
"I think I saw a split in the cliff down towards that direction," old Jen said helpfully, pointing out a thin crevice in the rock about 3 meters up the cliff face.
It was narrow, possibly too narrow, but New Jen figured that if she could get in there, it might turn out to be perfect. The fact that getting to it would require her to climb up the exact same cliff she'd just fallen down was an irony that was not lost on her. But it was fortunately a deeply fractured outcropping of stone and offered plenty of safe handholds. She was clambering up the wall and examining the crevice within mere moments, and in a surprisingly pleasant turn of events discovered that it was about as close to perfect as she could expect it to be. The crevice was a split in the stone that opened out into a more substantial cave where birds had clearly been making their home for a considerable length of time. None were home now, probably because it was winter, but the floor of the cavern was littered with all kinds of debris, and a tunnel seemed to retreat into the darkness where her eyes could not follow.
"Moment of truth now. Moment of truth now. Moment of truth now. Moment of truth now,"
she said to herself as she pressed her way into the gap. It was tight, almost too tight, and she had to draw in her diaphragm just to scrape her way through. But eventually she was inside and able to rest properly.
"Once upon a time, I wouldn't have been able to make that," she told herself, recalling her slight pudginess before her abduction.
That had transitioned into a starved gauntness when she was forced to ration her supplies, and later into the taut, well-defined body the cruiser and 3 months cross-country had given her. Old Jen missed the pudgier version, the girl of Earth. But if she'd been here today, she would have been killed thrice over. And that was all the evidence New Jen needed to see. And that was all the evidence New Jen needed to see to know how little that old version of her was worth. The cavern itself was flat-bottomed for the most part, although it trended downwards towards the back tunnel where no light fell. Fortunately, she had retained her instruments, and the light of the displays was more than enough to... And the light of the displays was more than sufficient to send light a decent distance down the dark corridor. It was narrow, uncomfortably so at the furthest point she could see, and was small enough to demand she get crouched to... But if she was in a pinch and needed to get deeper in the cave, she reckoned she could manage it. So if worst came to worst, at least crawling into a mountain was an option.
"Well, if worst comes to worst... If worst comes to worst, at least crawling into the mountain is an option," she said to herself, and started scooping the accumulated debris into a pile so that she didn't have to rest on cold, hard stone.
It was mostly sticks, but also included coniferous needles and bits of straw, all combined to make a very basic mattress that was not exactly chiropractor approved, but better than nothing. It was shelter, it was safety, and it was, for the moment, all that she had. She only wished she knew how much longer she would need to deal with it. Maybe the afternoon would bring other opportunities. The Mountains of Seerd, 2 days west of Dirktha.
The creature had vanished into the stone of the great cliff, clambering up the stone with supernatural ease, and simply squeezing itself into a space far too small for any mortal being to follow. Grotti put down the lens and looked over to Cavour. "It has disappeared into the cliff," he said. "I do not understand its actions." Cavour pondered, taking hold of the lens and using it to survey the situation for himself. "There are reptiles of the ground and sky who make their homes in such places. Perhaps it has relation to such things?" "I saw no wings on the creature," Grotti replied sharply. Expecting better of the astrologer now that he had more accurately gauged the old man's intelligence. Don't tell me you think it's supernatural as well." Cavour frowned, mulling over his answer. "I do not know what I believe it is, Lord Grotti," he admitted. "I have never seen anything like it." "Elder Tuck suggested it may be a Krevu," Grotti recalled. "But that seems equally unlikely."
"Elder Tuck invests too much credibility in stories told to children," Cavour replied, apparently blissfully ignorant of the hypocrisy of the statement when it came from the same man who predicted the future based on the appearance of the sky. "We do need to determine what it is, though. What are your thoughts on this, Lord Grotti?"
"I had imagined I would defer to the wisdom of the elders," Grotti lied in reply. He wasn't about to start letting a manipulative old man like Cavour get too much insight into the inner workings of his mind. Perhaps Elder Tuck could be persuaded to act in the capacity of a greeter? Cavour chuckled.
"Indeed. I am not so certain he is brave enough to volunteer for the role. I am certain he may be convinced to do so, however, so it is far from impossible. I think the main problem will be the fact it has made its home so far up the rock face."
The other main problem was that sending in Tuck may possibly provoke an otherwise peaceful spirit creature and bring ruin upon them all. But Grotti knew better than to talk that way about an elder, even to an elder who was known to harbor such enmity.
Then in that case, we will need somebody capable of climbing that sort of distance. And that rules out the elders and myself," Cavour decided. "That leaves yourself or Vade?"
"I will not send Vade into such danger," Grotti replied protectively. He and the younger lord had trained together since youth, but Grotti had always been better, and he had always been sure to keep the other lads from cornering Vade into a fight by himself. He wasn't about to send him into a situation that could be far more dangerous. Cavour stared at him expectantly, waiting for Grotti to make the offer where he volunteered.
"Then whom?"
"I shall go," Grotti decided. "But only after I have sent the creature in... But only after I have seen the creature in more detail. I will not go in blindly, Elder. We need to draw it out. And I think I have an idea." Record 573-Black-09. Recovered from C11-Orange-712-Yellow-6.
"Some naked girl, and then..." The latest bearer of the camera began, having just turned it on for recording.
"Naked girl?" a male voice asked, curiosity clearly piqued. The camera shifted over to a gaunt young male, clearly malnourished and with little of his brown body hair remaining. He did not look well, but he still seemed to have found this particular information interesting.
"And then some guys, they got shot. Then there's some police talking about killing the guy who took this camera from their bodies..."
She finished. Apparently while he was pleasuring himself? The tone she used for the last part seemed somewhat disgusted, and she handed off the camera to the male.
"So you can have it."
The male took hold of it and pointed it at the female, showing a female with an obvious family resemblance, but more body hair.
"And this is my sister, Oiri. The post-apocalyptic audience does not need to learn my name, Kanon," she rebuked. "Keep filming, though, because this will be good for the records."
"Assuming anybody survives to make any,"
Kinnon added rather negatively.
"Go on, though."
Oiri scowled at the camera.
"Stay positive, little brother."
"By 3 minutes," Kinnon interrupted.
still counts, O'Eary replied. We can't give up so close to the mountains.
Just talk about the bodies,
Kynon commanded. Well, hello, dear viewers, she said dramatically. You may like to know that those police you last witnessed, they're dead. Or at least I assume these two barbecued corpses are them. It looks like they've been here about a week or so.
Back on topic, Kynon told her. Talk about what we found.
A journal, O'Eary said brightly. I was going to take it over while Kynon was winding the dynamo.
Something only O'Eary Southor would force upon a cancer victim, Kynon interjected. My arm hasn't worked so hard since...
Since you had naked girls to look at? O'Eary teased. I know what you did in your room. Shut up!
Kynon shot back in horror.
People are going to see this! Well, they should know that the owner of this journal was police officer Relti Ovren, O'Eary said. O'Eary said more seriously. Ovren family, if you see this, I'm sorry to tell you that Relti is dead, but Relti also had an idea of what was killing everyone.
Which was? Kynon asked impatiently.
O'Eary paused for dramatic effect. She thought it was aliens.
That's stupid, Kynon replied immediately. If you're not going to be serious, then I'll just turn this off until you are.
O'Eary pouted.
End recording. That's stupid, Kynon responded immediately. If you're not going to be serious, then I'll just turn this off until you are. O'Eary pouted. End recording.
Hello, Clover. Jack, we are near the end of Salvage, yes. Fair enough, Jaxter. Okay, let's see.
Planet Cisco, Alpine region of northern continent. Jen could not rest easily. It was not late in the day, and she had not to do but sit around waiting for something. Or more likely nothing to happen, and she simply could not get comfortable to do it. This had already resulted in her getting up and pacing back and forth in the small confines of the little cave. Cave.
I need help. Yeah, Jack, this guy.
This had already resulted in her getting up and pacing back and forth in the small confines of the little cave. Itself a factor that did not sit well with her, ever so occasionally poking her head out of the little hole far enough to ensure that the debris pile remained unaltered, and that there was nothing new crawling over it. Nothing had been, of course. They'd probably seen that and have written her off along with their robots, if they cared at all. She poked her head out and drew back sharply when she did actually see something. A hairy biped who looked like a discount version of Chewbacca, maybe some kind of space yeti, all dressed up in crimson and ivory robes, was attempting to quietly make its way through the area. It had carried a white sheet, probably for camouflage in the white snow, and it seemed to have something else bundled within.
That was really weird, she whispered to herself.
It wasn't every day you saw an alien wearing clothes, let alone ones as vivid as that.
Maybe I've already gone mad?
She looked out there again, this time not seeing any sign of the bizarre creature. This time, however, two parceled items that were very obviously gifts had been placed at the foot of the nearest wannabe conifer. She decided to call it a conifo. Looking exactly like an offering, or, as it was more likely, bait for a really shitty trap.
It's a trap, she said, looking at them from her cliffside perch. It's got to be.
Not that it made any sense for this to be a trap. If they knew who and what she was, they could surely just blast the cave with plasma and be done with it. There was absolutely no reason she could think of for them to lure her out.
I'm not going out there, she told herself every time she looked down on them, and every time she looked around for any signs of the trap waiting to spring. Each time the gifts were still there, and each time there remained no sign of any enemies waiting to attack. There was also the possibility that there was somebody else out here who wasn't a friend to the owner of those robots, and in that case, the gifts may very well be a genuine gesture. And in that case, the gifts may very well be a genuine gesture, or at least that was the reason she gave herself when she finally decided to descend from the cave before the light of day gave out completely, and made her way to the base of the Conifo with the greatest stealth possible. The two gifts were covered in a form of fabric, but were well packed in a primitive fashion that Jen had never seen out in the galaxy. There was no plastic here, only natural materials as might be found at a hippie market back on Earth, and that, maybe that meant something? She wasted no further time in unwrapping the items, revealing a pile of soft, yellow mold and some finely produced fur.
Mold? That makes no sense. And fur? What's wrong with just giving jewelry and perfume?
The mold could stay where it was, although from the gag-inducingly pungent odor, it didn't seem entirely unlike the stinkiest cheeses she had experienced in her life on Earth. Furs she could use. Excuse me. Furs she could use, given the rapidly dropping temperature and the nature of her current habitat, and she bundled them back up and readied to depart. That was when she heard the snap of twigs and the rustle of movement, and once again saw the white and scarlet-robed Yeti man, along with three others, one in bright green and the other two in drab shades of gray. To another side, closer to the cliff, more of them rose from hiding, although only one wore robes of significantly vivid coloration, a sharp blue and yellow combination.
"Hold there, being of the other world,"
the white and scarlet-clad one said.
"We are come from Dektha, grandest city of the Aguaran race, and bring gifts of Kavaktzi and the finest furs of wild Popereth. May I present to you Elders Tak, Borovud, and Kavor, the bravest of the wise men of our people."
Three wise men and a bunch of gifts?
Jen thought, looking down at the furs she clutched in her hand.
No, it couldn't be. There's not even a baby.
The green-robed Yeti man stepped forward, and now that Jen had a proper look at him, he did seem to harbor a greater measure of age than the one wearing white and scarlet. He approached carefully, timidly, not wanting to appear any more threatening than a bunch of space Yeti soldiers surrounding her already did, and he held up hands as he edged forward.
"I mean you no harm, noble Otherworlder, but we must know one thing. Are you here to deliver us from the evil of the Dark One? Can you possibly be the fabled Chosen One?"
"Are you fucking kidding me?"
Jen asked in reply, more disgusted with falling into this stereotypical sci-fi show situation than anything else. Were they natives? That was supposedly impossible on a death world. Yet Earth had clearly managed it, so why not another? Could this have been the secret that the aliens were protecting? There was only one answer to a question like that, however. Be it, "Are you the Chosen One?" or "Are you a god?" the answer was the same.
"Yes."
The green-robed one looked back to the others, expressing confusion.
"I believe it does not speak the language of our people."
"You can't understand me? You can't understand me?"
she asked in surprise, not having expected communication to be one way. It seemed as though it should be all or nothing, the latter especially when it came to primitive cultures, and that begged another kind of question.
"So why the fuck can I understand you?"
Mountain Lair of the Dark One. 1:30 was on the cusp of escaping. Escape was the ultimate goal of her ancient scheme to get off this awful rock before anybody else did. That was of primary importance. Long ago, too long for the number to really make sense, back when the purge of this death world had been drawing to its close, her ship, the last to leave, had been downed by one of the dying natives in such a way that it rendered it useless for either communications or flight. And as there was no reason for anyone to return to double-check on a species quickly going extinct, there was also no reason for them to find her. She probably had a duplicate out there, crafted from some backup she had made before everything went badly. Crafted from some backup she had made before everything went badly wrong. Things had, in fact, gone badly wrong in a number of other ways. One of those ways was the fact that the species they had intended to wipe out had somehow managed to survive. That could not have been predicted. The Deathworlders were violent and savage, and 130 couldn't imagine them having set aside their differences for long enough to survive and recover from nuclear winter and radioactivity. She had noticed the resurgence when it was too late, and ultimately had ceased sending out her ever-dwindling supply of micro-abrogators in preference of waiting for another kind of opportunity. She knew she needed assistance, because otherwise the galaxy would once again face the threat of Deathworlders spilling out into the stars. No matter the cost, that could not be allowed, and she had expended the last of her missiles to bring down the small exploratory ship that had attempted to land. Taking that course of action had been important in order to maintain total secrecy. There was no way a proper inspection would fail to discover a race of Deathworlders. But it had been far more important to take it in a salvageable state with the communications systems intact. It certainly hadn't helped that this world was located in the least desirable section of the galaxy, where the Galactic Senate would never engage in habitation efforts of any kind. In normal space, the standard sublight radio might have been picked up, but in the nebula, its weak signal would be lost in the noise. Finally, she had a mostly functional ship and an entirely functional communications system, and it took all of her willpower not to start broadcasting her distress call right away. It was more important to discover what had happened in the aeons since she was stranded. 130 reclined in her command chair and enjoyed the familiar sensation of the link activating with the ship computer. Then she began to explore the alien databanks. She didn't like what she found. All right, guys, that's going to do it for this one. Thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it, as always. If you could like, comment, and subscribe, give me your firstborn, a blood sample, and 2 weeks' notice. That would be fantastic. Also, your papers. Your papers, please. Papers, please. Sorry, I'm trying to be like the gayest Berliner who ever existed. And it's like, oh, nein, what are you saying? We would never do such a thing. But also, could I see your papers, please? Thank you so much, Jack. I appreciate that on the kid. Oh, by the way, guys, I'm having a baby. A bouncing baby boy is coming.
This summer. Coming this summer. A bouncing baby boy whose name I am struggling to come up with my wife. No, I don't need any suggestions, but thank you for asking.
Anyway, guys. I will talk to you later on this one. As always, I love you, and I will see you in the next one. Bye!
Bye! Au revoir, farewell, auf Wiedersehen, goodbye. I leave and heave a sigh and say goodbye. Goodbye.
Chicken tenders. All right, that should do it. There, he's got over an hour of shit to edit. That should make him happy. Gregor, here's an hour of shit. I was only going to do 30 minutes, and I did a whole hour.
73, it's called. What was this one called again? I don't remember. Crashing through the snow in a one-horse open sleigh. O'er the fields we go. Laughing all the way. Ha, ha, ha.
I miss Christmas already. It's like my favorite part about winter. Christmas is a lot of fun. Just the whole part of the season. Edelweiss is a
Edelweiss.
Also the opening to The Man in the Tower or whatever it is. I can't remember what it's called.
The Man in the High Tower. The Man in the High Tower, yes.
It's a new day.
Die Sonne kommt op in het Osten.
Man in the High Castle. Jesus. The show is fucking crazy, by the way. If you haven't watched or read, because I believe it is also a book by, I don't think it's Philip. What? Who the hell wrote The Man in the High Castle? Philip K. Dick. I was right. It actually is Philip K. Dick. I don't know why I thought it wasn't for a second. It was weird. The did a little bit freedom. Not entirely, though. I think that was a woman. The show was interesting. It got weirder as the seasons went on. Because, like, the book is pretty interesting. I can't really tell you a lot about it without spoiling some major fucking, like, points about the book. But, yeah. Yes, casual. It is, in fact, actually a Philip K. Dick move. Oh, God. What time is it? 6? Katie is going to go to yoga here soon. There is a registered offender alert for my neighborhood. Great. Great. I know, but I try not to anyway. Like, just because, like, I've had shows spoiled for me that I wasn't super happy about, even though I knew they were older. And, like, I had managed to just completely avoid any mention of the spoilers until suddenly I hadn't. Actually, one that I didn't really get spoiled on, but I do know something that I wish I didn't about One Piece. I saw a grave that I really wish I hadn't seen, because now I know something that I wish I didn't know. But also, One Piece is fucking wild. That show, I thought it was just like a silly little shonen anime. There's a lot going on in that show, man. There's a lot of foreshadowing and, like, just sort of, like, concepts that Oda puts together and, like, apparently just lies in wait for, like, ages to bring them back up. Yeah, exactly, right, Jack? Like, that's the thing, is, like, sometimes... I get that for certain things, like Star Wars and, like, Castaway, or, like, you know, Touchstone movies and things like that that most people probably have seen, and if they haven't, they probably won't ever watch it, you know? But who knows? My channel's not for kids, but if they're fucking watching because they're really cool, then, you know, I don't want to spoil for them either, because there's a lot of crap. I kind of want to make something in Canva, but I don't know what. Nope, I'm already going in. Come on. Let's turn on some music. this down here. Put the speckers on. Listen to that later.
Wolfsig.
Oh man, Andrew Huang is awesome. I don't know if you guys are.
Hey, I'm doing a couple music production masterclasses next month. I'm going to show you some tricks, take your questions, and give feedback on some people's tracks. So if you want to join the live stream, just pre-order my new book, Make Your Own Rules. If you order it as a hardcover, audiobook, or ebook before February 6th, you can put your info into my website and I'll send you all the details and you'll have access to these masterclasses. So I haven't talked about my hearing issues on this channel in a couple years. This is coming because I've reached a point or past a point where I really feel like I could use your input on how to move forward in some ways. So I'll get to that in a bit, but
he's been suffering from like hearing loss for a while, and it's slowly degrading his ability to hear certain tones, and I guess it's been getting worse, and that really sucks. I really like Andrew. His content is awesome, and the one that I really like is his Andrew Huang Four Producers. His Four Producers series is fantastic. He basically takes a piece of music, and then four different producers take a crack at remixing it. It's nice. Yeah, the spoilery title and thumbnails on videos is always great. It's like, what is... like, I almost said the one about Snape. Sorry, guitar into banana? That's gross.
We're back for another season.
That's season gross. Two. That's gross. Why would you do that? Four producers, one sample.
Hey, it's Andrew Huang. So this video is going to be kind of a Hey, it's Andrew Huang. Welcome to another episode of Four Producers Flip the Same Sample, the show where everything's made up and the points don't matter. In today's episode, our guests will be Janna, Mr. Bill, and Diala. The four of us are going to take the same audio sample and use it as the basis of a new track, whether it's an entirely new creation or just a remix of the original piece. This is really about how creative minds will take the same material to completely different places. One thing we're going to do different from the last video is we're not going to be allowed to sample a whole song. I really want to be able to play the full sample in the video so you can all hear exactly what we have to work with.
Yep.
Last time it led to a bit of confusion. So without further ado, let's introduce this sample. It's the intro from my friend Melinda's new song, Running. She just dropped a really great record, so that's how we picked the sample this time. Nepotism. She's one of my favorite YouTubers and just humans in general, so I want to support her. Here's the sample.
One day you're talking sweet and telling me you'll stay, and I believed every damn word you'd say.
Water.
I'm not sure
water
how the clouds gathered so fast, but once the rain started pouring, I knew this flood would last.
Janna, I am a producer slash DJ and I'm very excited to be part of this project. So when I first heard the sample, I got a really grungy and edgy sort of vibe from it. First, I started off by using the first part of the vocal sample, making it into like an overlaying pad. It sits across the entire track except for parts of the drop, and it kind of gives a consistent ambient sound towards the entire track. But then I start to layer my own instruments by adding a very reverbed out piano, and I also add in my own hip-hop beats. I start to bring up more instruments when the build-up starts. During the build-up section, I decided to play with part of the sample. I duplicated it, multiplying it many times. I am also pitching up the key of the sample. And here I have my drop.
It's a bit darker sounding.
Can't wait to see where this goes. Gathered so fast, but once the rain started pouring, I knew
this flood would last. Oh, yeah.
Here we go. Classic. Yeah, it's so hype. It's so hype.
Bring it.
Contrast with the rhythm.
Whew. Yeah, Jenna, you really brought it.
It's good. I like it.
I'm envisioning like a chase scene through a prison.
That was epic. Like a fight scene. I kept getting hit in the face, you know?
Shit, I forgot the water. Damn it. Ow! Whoa!
Hey, how you going? Mr. Bill here. And today, Andrew Huang asked me to flip a sample. I wanted to make it as abstract and glitchy and strange as possible whilst still keeping the general vibe of the sample. Allow me to get turned. So the first thing I did was I just tried to make some form of like pad, and I tried to remove as much of the melody out of the vocal in this as possible because I didn't want to be influenced too much by the vocal melody itself. So I put one in a sampler and then I just looped one. So we have one that's looping over four bars and one that's looping like every quarter note or something like that, which gives the the tune a pace from the get-go. So the second thing that I did is I took one of the parts of her vocals where she just said like R or E or something like that, and I just took that tiny little sample and I put a reverb on it and then I rendered it. So it's kind of just like an R or something, but with a long reverb on it. And then I used that to make this chord progression. But I didn't introduce that instantly. I kind of
filtered
that.
I love Mr. Bill. Like a bit intense. He's so awesome. Instantly.
So this here is the main vocal, basically. I used a few different glitching effects and just kind of rendered them all out. So if I just drag all these out, you kind of hear what they all sound
it's
like.
It's a Philip K. Dick move, that's right.
And then I just took little chops of it that I liked and mixed that in with the dry vocal, so you get something like this.
You'll never guess what happened to Jesus, thumbnail. He died?
We can talk about this vocal riser too. This is essentially the same as what I put into this sampler. It's just like a little R with like some reverb, except just reversed. It just makes a nice little sort of ambient background layer riser. We should talk about this percussion actually. So this brain dance percussion came across that sound like
Bill, I love you.
So then I
but
just
only producers care what you're doing.
Like this.
Glitchy, man.
Ah, what?
Wow, so much Beethoven.
Build it up. Let's go, baby. This is sick.
This syncopation is crazy, man.
This is so cool.
that's really nice in the background.
This is so glitchy, man. I love it. Oh.
Your sound design is always so intricate.
Really cool.
Ooh, I have no words.
Well, my initial thoughts with the sample was that, you know, it was sad and I didn't want it to be. So I changed it up. I made it happy. I put the sample into simpler and pitched it up 4 semitones. I then EQ'd out the low end of the sample. And this gave me more room to make up my own bass line, which would then manipulate the song into sounding like it was a happy song. I just played around with the sample for a while until I came up with this riff. It had a bit of a pumping feel, so I put a kick on the beat to really drive that. I grabbed my bass guitar and just started playing around with riffs and came up with this. I then picked up my guitar and I ended up with 2 separate pieces that play together. So I just making the song and the videos and things like that. So I hope you enjoy and I'll see you next time.
Her whole reaction is just, what?
Oh, I like the guitar plug cami.
Shit, I... It's so warm and uplifting.
One day you're talking to... One day you're talking
to... That's cool, she's done the same sort of thing as me with the looping a little bit by ambience.
Wow, well, she completely changed the vocal melody. The original sample was like in a minor key, and she changed it to a major key for this song.
These drums are so clean.
Whoa, I love that snare. It's like so back in the mix.
It's good vibes, good vibes.
Interesting change up.
Oh, wow. It's so detailed. I love it.
There's 4/4 there, but for some reason it's still eluding me to like a halftime thing.
This is a really different take of the original sample. Like, I would have never imagined this. I like the chorus slash drop.
This part feels huge. Niall always brings the summer vibes.
That is so cool. I really like it.
Good stuff. I like it.
Nice one. Great atmosphere.
That's fantastic. Oh my god.
Did I miss Janice?
I decided to...
I did. Who cares? Anywho's it's... Probably just got this video demonetized somehow. Just by playing the little bits of songs. Oh. What should we do? My throat's feeling a little bit right now. Because of the gruff. It's been very poggers so far. Yes, Genesis is poggers. So is Judges. Judges is even more poggers. Ruth was a fucking... Yep. Ruth! Solomon. Or no, Samson? Was he a judge? I think Samson was a judge. Yes, dearest. Okay, I love you very much. Have fun, okay? Yes, ma'am. Fudge. I was supposed to help him with that. Hello, Odin Spear. How are you? Oh my god, hi. Oh my god, hi. Hello. Oh my god, of course. Yes, it's you. Boink. I don't want to do anything in Canva anymore. I gotta finish Slay the Spire. Let's go back to echo canceling speaker FUD. Wait, is it really? There's no sound? I just like having the sound. It's just, it's important to me. I got the sounds back. I didn't get neutralized, son of a bitch. Well, that'll have to do. I was really hoping for neutralized because that would have basically gotten me to the point where I took like 2 damage. Or 1. Sorry, Saint. I don't know why your chat's lagging. That's weird. Yeah, Slay the Spire is a ton of fun, Taku. All good, bud. Now I have it. Take 1 damage. Yes, that's true. Awagubus. Saint, you're behind a few other people in that particular category who have also asked for that same thing. But I mean, eventually probably yes. I'm just very behind on said requests. Yeah, that what Freedom said, in about 50 years. Or if I get if I get laid off, oh god, or when I'm taking care of the baby, I'll be able to do it probably, because I'm gonna have to stay up until like 1 o'clock in the morning every day so that I can take care of the baby for a certain amount of time into the night, and then Katie can sleep, and then she can get up for a little while, and then take care of the baby, and then I'll take care of the baby after that. Very true, Saint. And I don't knock you for asking at all. Let me be clear. Let me be clear. yeah, we do that.
We do this and this.
See you, casual death worlder. So sorry to hear that, bud. Feel better. No, Saint, I don't know how to do that, because I am old. Guess that didn't really matter. I was going to kill him no matter what. Hey, there's acrobatics. That's a great card. Yeah, let's remove another strike. Chiropteran biddies. That sucks. Well, bang, bang. That's all I got right now. And I got all my defends were in there. Fuck. A blur, defend, and piercing wail, hopefully, and maybe neutralize. Maybe I get all of them. No, I did not. Nope. Let's do this. Let's do survivor. Quick slash. Piercing wail. Fuck you, buddy. Get blur out. Couldn't use it though. I'm just slow. I take a long time to do stuff because stuff is hard. There's more of that. Another flying knee. Yeah, let's just do that. It's only 4 damage. I don't give a shit. The more damage we can do to him, the better. Fireball. No, come on. Oh! Still get to do that 16 damage, even though I don't get to keep the extra energy from that. Because it didn't meet the requirements. Fine. I'm so glad to hear that, Saint. Thank you, man. I hope to God that that's how most people feel, because I know shit is fucking nutty. Nutty buddy nutty. No blur. Oh well. Do 6 more damage. If that's all I'm able to do, I'm happy. If I'm just able to spread just a little bit of you know, making time a little bit more bearable in the face of entropy, I am happy to do it. And that sounded much more grim than I meant it to. I'm serious. I really am. I am so glad that you feel that way. I keep forgetting I put my water over here, and I keep looking over here for it, and it's not there. That's not how it works. It doesn't just reappear over here. Sneaky strike! And then strike, and then blur, and then defend. Thank you again, Saint. I appreciate it. I truly do. Okay, so that's 18. I'll take 1 damage. Wish I had Caltrops for this one. That's a lot of damage I would have given him. I would have given him the same amount that he would have given me had I not blocked all of it. No, let's fuck him up. Let's fuck him up! Well, I'm really glad that you got to see a stream. I know it's so sporadic. I don't really have a schedule, so it's hard to know when I will be. But I'm trying to be better about putting it in the Discord at the very least and, you know, letting people know that it's going to be happening. So hopefully that's... Oh, damn it. I forgot Burn was... There was a Burn Plus. Yeah, Gregor is indispensable. I really appreciate him helping me out with editing. And I have given him more to edit. May he be pleased. Treat him like a feral deity. May he be pleased and do the editing. Yay. Oh, I know he always appreciates people shouting him out and all. Oh, damn it, I have no way of blocking this. Shouting him out. And I do try to make sure I put his... He's got like a tip jar. So if you see that in the description of the video, please do click and go take a look. Also, I'm not sure the timeline on it, but his story he has called the Lubinian. Well, it's framed as like a, I actually really like it. The way that he's structured it is like a column almost that he, has a character that writes, if I'm not mistaken, called, and it's in the Lubinian Gazette. It might be. I don't know what else explains it. Fuck, hold on. No, I'm okay. So 8 plus 7 is 15, so I'll take 2 damage. Yes, it's to appease Gregor, and also make sure that he doesn't awaken too fully. 8. Oh, I'm so close. No. I think I needed to actually do 2 defends instead. It wouldn't have mattered. 7 times 6 is 35. Are you fucking kidding me? 4 damage away. 4 damage away from beating this boss. Oh, balls. That's frustrating. Damn it. That sucks. Frustrating. That's very frustrating. But what can you do? I'm on an ascension. And I gotta keep trying. Gotta get to ascension 5. Okay. Hell yeah. Let's remove 2 cards. Yeah, it does. It does suck, bud. But hey, what can you do? Wah, 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 wah. Yeah. Honestly, I'm not sure how he does it. I feel like he probably just doesn't sleep. Especially with 2 kids. God, I'm so excited, though. I didn't care, boy or girl. Just excited to have the baby, but like, and just excited, you know, just wanted to be healthy and happy more than anything else. But Katie told me, in just the most benign way. I don't know how else to explain it. Just like she didn't let on anything. She told me while I was at the gym one day that she needed my help with something when I got home. I was like, okay, cool. You know, nothing unusual about that. It's a normal request. She doesn't always tell me exactly what she needs, you know? And so I go downstairs and she's holding baby clothes. And I mean, I already knew she was pregnant. But we'd been waiting for the results and we had just talked like earlier that day about like, you know, hoping that we got them soon. And she was holding baby clothes and she goes, can you help me with something? I just need to decide which of these is the most gender neutral. I'm like, okay, sure. Why? Because we're having a boy. She had gotten a call while I was at the gym, basically, to check in and everything from her doctor, and all of the information was on her little like my chart thing, and I was just so excited. I can't wait, She's officially in the second trimester, so two trimesters to go, right? That's how it works. This trimester and then the next one. The baby is officially the size of a navel orange. And he apparently likes to just be upside down right now. Upside down all the time. Boop, boop, boop. Oh, dang it. I'm gonna take 5 damage I didn't need to take. Jesus. Is this the first guy? I've taken this much damage from a stupid fucking crow? I've not been paying attention. I gotta be better about that. We'll do Cloak and Dagger. That's a fun one. We'll just head up this way. Dun. Calipers aren't even that good. That makes me sad. A lowercase threat. That's funny. Yeah. Little baby boy. Fuck you! My potion did 20 damage, so he can eat it! Yay! Dagger throw is one of my favorite attacks. That's a really good one. Yeah, we've been thinking about names. We haven't really been discussing them with people because some of them can't behave and say stuff that they shouldn't say. So. That's not to throw any shade at any of you, obviously. It's just certain members of my family are unable to help themselves. I love them dearly, but Lord howdy, everybody's got an opinion in my family about what name I should name my baby. Thank you so much, Henrik. W isn't even... W's like 2 letters above. I don't know how you did that, bud. Impressive. Survivor, because then I can just do this and then this. Dead! They're all dead, Jim. Let's do Bouncing Flask. That's a very good card. Alright, hopefully we have enough now to kill. Oh, it's these! Shit! These are actually really tough with this person. Alright. Yeah, we'll go for that one. Do that. Block the damage. Hit. Giant thumbs, small keyboard. That will do it. YouTube stupidity being neither here nor there at that point. Ooh, this is perfect for them. Fuck them. That one actually gets poisoned, and actually that one gets poisoned too. Nice. I should block a little, but I really don't want to. Give me neutralize. Come on, come on, come on, come on, you fuckers. Could have at least alleviated this 20 damage I'm about to get hit with. Could have been. Yeah, because Ren is an actual word, and Zren is not. It's a bird, I believe. A Ren. Damn. I should have... Oh, there we go. Yeah, I believe a Ren is a bird. A beard. A beard. Okay, let's go with... Oh, that won't weaken him. Fuck off. All right. Well, that sucks a whole bunch of ass. At least that one doesn't have its artifact anymore, so I can actually start... that. I hate dazed. Taking up stuff in my stuff. Calipers are good if I get a bunch of block cards that are really, really good. But this guy doesn't... This character doesn't have a ton of good block cards, unfortunately. Now I take one damage and I get this one down to 22, which is within reach of some combinations of cards of killing. Oh, it's 20. Or 19, technically. Ow! Stop hitting me. Fuck. Well, if I get 3 days, there's not a whole lot. There's 3 more days in the next one. It just is a card I can't play. At least they evaporate after a while since they're ethereal. If I don't play them, they just kind of... Shit, I'm dead. I'm literally dead unless I get the thing that makes him weak for zero. Nope. I'm dead. God, this is so bad. I'm getting my ass kicked by this fucking PvE game. I swear I usually do better than this. I'm dead. I literally am dead. Fuck. That sucks. I'm also making very suspect choices a lot of the time. All right. Fuck this. We're gonna... He's gonna yell at us. If you don't make it to the first boss, you only get 2 choices. It's like, hey, you need help. The option you chose was clearly not one for you. Okay, so we're going to try to make it a little easier on you. Maybe get you through these enemies a little bit better. You only have to fight ones with 1 health. All right, so let's go straight up here. Hold on now. 1, 2, 3. Yeah, I could get to that one or that one. Okay, let's do that. Yeah, this was the right call. Die, die. I do like Finisher. It's a fun card. Brum, 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 bum, bum. Bum, 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 bum. Prepared's a good card. So is Poison Stab. Reflex is quite a good card. Don't have enough money right now to get certain things done. I'm going to look at the map. This will for sure be... I think that's what we're going to do. I'm going to leave. I'm going to proceed. This one. Beautiful. Poison Stab. That's not bad. Then go through here. See anything I want this time? Caltrops isn't bad. Deflect isn't bad. But I think we're just going to remove a card. It's going to be Strike. And then we're going to go here, and he'll have one health. Good. I fucking hate this piece of shit elite. He's so annoying to play against. Alchemize is really good. Probably just going to take that. Mm-hmm. Spin the wheel. Take one of my cards away. Nah, heals is not bad. Yeah. Gets me all the way to full, which is kind of nice. Didn't really need it that much. What was the name? Boink. Sorry, text. Oh, thank you so much. Yeah, happy Valentine's Day to everybody. We just did ours early. We did a massage yesterday. Oh, hell yeah. Boom. We did a massage yesterday, and then we did dinner. It was really nice. It was a good time. Sucker Punch is good. Shiv is also good. That's multi-purpose. That gives you both healing and that good, good Shiv. Ooh, I do like Orichalcum. That's a helpful one when you don't have any fucking healing. Or, armor. Defense. Okay, this is a tough one. Boom. Booyakasha. Hachiburikaro. Bubbo, so loud. I'm actually going to drink that too, because later on he's going to hit me with an attack that takes down my strength and my agility. So I would like that to not be the case. Okay. Poison stab. Take 7 damage or 12. Hit him. Well, that's pretty cool. That sounds great, Tahaku. I would love that if it could just do that for me. You have to get through Lagavulin faster than you otherwise would be safe, because this thing's such a piece of shit. Because it keeps decreasing your stuff. Oh, I got the mask. Yes. That's very cool. Let's get Bane. Let's go here. I got Distilled Chaos, which is really cool. That's a great card. Let's do this. Let's do Cloaky Dagger. Shiv him. Yeah. And if you get the potion belt, that's pretty cool, but like otherwise it's kind of a bitch and a half. That and then that. And then we'll just doop, doop, doop. Oh, that would have absolutely fucking. He's already dead. He's dead. Neat. I actually didn't get to play Alchemize, which kind of sucks. I needed to do that. Slice. Let's do Masterful Stab. That's a great card. Just don't take damage. That's your big thing with that one. So neutralize. Shiv. I can do just regular defend. And then I can do finisher. All right, Clover, enjoy work. See you later. Let's do that. Oh, you had the potion belt. Wow. That, yeah, you were getting a ton of potions then. Dead. I'm getting a ton of potions. I don't even have the thing that gives me potions every turn. That's wild. Oh, I really like Tactician. It's a great card. I am very low and worried that this might kill me. Yeah, we'll just go through here. Ah, yeah, that will definitely do it. Shiv. And they're both dead next turn. Neat. We'll just kill him. Alright. Whatever. Doesn't really matter. I don't need to do that. That's kind of ridiculous. Boom. Dead. Dagger throw. I wish that this instead gave you another card and discard, but that's fine. Let's do accuracy. If you go really fast, it seems to give you one every time. Okay, it's this guy. I do need to heal. Yeah, that's always good. I like smithing at the camps. Or if I get the shovel, I like to dig a lot. That's pretty great. I should use this. Weakened. Defend. And then finisher. Yes, I'm going to take 10 damage, but I'm also going to give him all of that. Yeah, the shovel's really good. Ah, masterful stab is now useless! Alchemize. Ghost in a Jar is great. Love Ghost in a Jar. Tangible is a wonderful, helpful thing. Intangible. Weakened poison stab. Boom. Well, shit. I do this, this, and this. That's all I could do. Still at half. Or a little above half. I don't like that. So let's just strack. Yeah. We're gonna save that intangible until we get all the way back around to his other motherfucking thing. Once he gets back to his six-way attack, we'll use intangible. Yep, we sure fucking will. You will deal no damage to me and a bunch to yourself. Hip, hip, hooray. Puppo, bark. Bubbo, what is it? Come on up. Come here, boy. Actually, what time is it? You probably want... Yeah, I gotta feed him here in a second. Him want food, because it's time. It is time for my dog to eat.
Thus saith the spider.
Boop. Hello? Ooh, corpse explosion is awesome. Hello? Hello? Hi, So-So! Hi, sister!
Hi, brother!
Oh, no. Oh, eh. Eh. Just do that. It's fine. I've been watching Buffy the Vampire Slayer with my wife. It's very good. I watched it when I was younger, but she has not seen it, so they're all new for her. For me, it's sort of like watching it again, you know, but without the mystery sort of part of it. I just know what's going to happen. That's why I love that card right there. Because now I take no damage and I just dealt a fuckload and we'll drink this. I'm going to take Nightmare because, damn it. Damn it. I wish I'd drank that first now.
To nourish and sate the hollow of the belly. Yes, verily, he doth engage his overdrive.
Although now my niece is here, she might feed him for me because she loves me. Hey, look at that. Entropic Brew. 2 strength and a colorless potion. Could have killed him right there with the extra strength, but like, I'll save that. Kill something that's harder than him. Boink. Well, that sucks. Let's see what this colorless card can do. What's up, Soso? Hi. Yeah, go ahead. I'm streaming though, so stay over that way. You want a hug?
Mm-hmm. What you eating?
A donut.
Ooh, donuts.
Chocolate donut.
Chocolate donut.
Right.
Sure. Where'd you get this? Oh, it's a hard chocolate shell.
Happy Valentine's Day.
What did Dominic get you?
Oh, yeah. We ended like a month ago. I thought Ron told you.
You don't tell me anything.
I should have thought your sister already told you.
No. Why would no one tell me?
You both know I don't talk about my feelings.
Great.
I know, it's a problem.
I just love you very much.
But I did get Hunter something.
Who's Hunter? Is he the one we played What's It Called with? Mm-hmm. And he's your new boyfriend?
No, not yet.
Oh my god, so
I've waited a month.
You're
because my friend told me to wait a month.
You discover a colorful shop with the banner Inspire and walk in to see what's inside. Nope, no way, nope, can't let you in. A man with ridiculous clothing appears at the entrance to bar you.
I got Hunter 3 of his favorite candies and 2 of his favorite sodas.
Hmm?
I got Hunter 3 of his favorite candies and 2 of his favorite sodas.
Well, that's nice.
I got him a Mountain Dew, a Coke, M&M's, Snickers, and Reese's. I mean, not Reese's, and Twix.
Oh. That's not too bad. Mm-hmm. I love all of those things.
No. And then my friend Demi got me a mini bag of Snickers. I finished them in 5 minutes.
How is Demi doing?
Good. Me and her are still cool.
Okay.
She got me a mini bag of Snickers. I finished it in 5 minutes.
Wow.
I like Snickers. I like food in there.
Food's good.
Food's yummy. Next Tuesday. Scaled.
Yes, sometimes things are scary, but I believe in you, okay? You're gonna do fine. You're gonna do great. You're gonna do great, sweetie. It'll be fine. Don't even worry about it. Ow! Freedom wants you to know that he also does not talk about his feelings. I have no idea who she is, but I feel she needs to know. It's my niece. And Tahaku says noms are the best. Also, Lincoln, stop jumping. Are you okay?
I'm always okay.
He scratch you?
I'm always okay.
Lincoln, hey, that's just an empty bottle, bud. There's nothing in it.
And I'm also really sore because Sophia did an oopsie.
Sophia did an oopsie?
Yeah.
What did she do?
I overworked myself.
That will happen when you do that, yeah.
I decided it was a grand idea to play volleyball 2 days ago for 4 hours straight. outside because I needed to work on things. I wasn't doing what I was supposed to be doing.
You have to take it a step at a time, though, because otherwise you will burn yourself out.
After I worked on one main thing, which was my spikes, yeah, my left side of my back hurts, my left shoulder hurts, my right arm hurts.
Oh, wow. How surprising.
And then today I also worked.
Everyone believes in you, by the way.
Thank you.
I call these walking turds, Freedom. That's funny. You call it a booger. It's fine. It's not. It's just a bottle. I'm not worried about it. He's just a boy.
And then today I worked on more space, which I regret doing.
Yeah.
Very much so.
Well, that didn't do anything.
I had good spikes.
Good spikes. Just be careful and don't hurt yourself too much, please. Thanks. Thanks for no promises.
I'll be careful some of the time.
Some of the time?
Yeah.
I guess that's better than none of the time.
I'm not a gentle giant.
You're not a giant.
Hey,
you're normal-sized. You're normal-sized person.
I'm somewhat tall.
Okay. I love you whole bunches, you know. Shiv, she is at yoga. Yes.
Yeah, yo.
Dead booger! Not you. This one.
Clearly, because I'm still alive.
Yes, thank goodness.
Yeah.
Alright, love you whole bunches.
Yeah, you whole bunches.
Alright. Why do they have glitter on them? That's pretty good.
No, put it back. Oh my god, you're seeing her live. Hey! Hey, I need you to bring the scissors really quick. I need you to bring the scissors really quick.
Hey, Bob. Can you drop that, please? Can you let that go? There's nothing in it.
Right. Oh, okay. I made it. Oh no, I bet it did. Did I use the potion card when I had full potions? I didn't notice. That's pretty stupid of me then. Probably just wasn't thinking about it. Random attacks. Let's just remove another attack. I I only have one way of getting rid of cards right now, and I'd really like another one. I need another way of getting rid, like, discarding cards. I'm gonna pick that. And we're gonna leave, and then we're gonna proceed. I'm gonna go here, here, here. Yep, I bet. Alright, let's use at least one strength potion. I hate this motherfucker. What's that? Blade dance. Poison stab. 8 times 3 is what, 24? So plus 12 would be 20. Fuck you. Strippers do explode sometimes, as they are wont to do. Damn. It's gonna deal a little bit of damage to me. 16, I believe, which is unfortunate. You want to remove cards so that your deck is only the better cards. Like, Strike is not the worst card in the world, nor is Defend, but there are much, much better cards than those. And if you have those as the majority of what you have in your deck, you'll get through them and you'll have access to them more often. Then a higher proportion of your deck is made of the good cards, essentially. Ooh, there's another way to do it. But that's it's a weird one. I like that card, but it's a later game card. All right, this is going to be a chest, but it will have a curse, which kind of sucks. That's a good one. Nunchuckle. Now I have to do another curse, which is going to be rough. Okay, let's see. Okay, we'll go this way, because... Sure, yeah. I just like using the discard cards themselves for that. It seems to be just slightly more effective on the whole, at least to me. I mean, everybody has their own play style, so I'm not saying anything is better or worse than anything else. Let's drink that. Let's drink that. Let's do Blade Dance. Let's do Masterful Stab. Let's do Strike. Shiv. And then we'll do this. That's 50 damage. Almost dead. Damn it! So close. Yeah, that's not a bad idea. Ooh, well, balls. Shit the bed, Fred. And this is all I can really do. Is that, and then just take, I'm just gonna take the fucking 11 damage. No, 5! I forgot about Orichalcum. That's fair, Freedom. Yeah, especially since even when I try to actually do the what you call it, the AMA, no one ends up joining. So yeah, that's not a bad idea at all. Nice. Yeah, that's a good idea. I like that. Oh man, what should I do? This one's actually pretty good. Ooh, which... Ooh, I kind of want to go this way. I bet you are, Saint. That stuff never goes away. It's like the herpes of craft supplies, I believe someone once called it. Okay, here we go. Let's do blade dance. One, two, three. And he's out of the air. And then we can do masterful strike. And then bane. And then defend. And then survivor. And we will get rid of that. Booyakasha. That's a good one. Oh yeah, that's totally fair then. I didn't even think about that. That would make that a lot easier, huh? Dagger spray! Then I do that and I get the energy back. I only get poison stab and accuracy. It's alright. Yeah, I will have to, Freedom, I will have to look into doing that then, because that's a pretty good idea. Man, I'm about to get my shit rocked! Take 14 damage. I'm gonna be down to 30, and it would have been better for me not to play that card, that defend, because I would have gotten one extra defend, one extra armor. There we go. The artisanal clap. Ooh. That jives real good, but I don't have any way of making them vulnerable, and Terror Zero is it's a good card. Four shivs. I can just upgrade the blade dance that I do have. And I need to get rid of some of these fucking... Oh. This is a choice. This is an interesting choice. You lose 23 max HP, but you receive bites, and it takes away all your strikes. So I would lose 3 strikes, and I would gain 5 bites. And every time I attack with those, I deal 7 damage and heal for 2. I don't usually do it, but something is telling me to do it today. So I'm gonna. And then we are going to get rid of one of these bad boys down here. This one, since that one is just unplayable. There's Bouncing Flask. Oh, but then there's also Medical Kit, which makes status cards playable, which is really good. Ooh, Ghost in a Jar is really good too. Where do you see Health Steal? The Health Steal. Oh yeah, with Bite. That is really good. And if you get, there's a certain relic that you can get too that doubles the amount of healing in like while you're fighting, and then that means you get 4 instead. And I think if you upgrade it, it's, let me look. These 10 and 3, or 8 and 3, excuse me. So that goes up to 6 if you have the double one, which is absolutely ridiculous. That's an amazing amount of healing. None of these are really lighting my fire here. Like, Bouncing Flask a little, but not really. This is rough. That one's not bad. No, we're just gonna proceed. We're gonna go to the campfire. Oh, big and scary.
Big and scary. Grr.
Don't die, please.
I do make promises on.
Just be careful, please. That's all I ask. Why, thank you. Why, thank you for trying. I feel that I should rest, but I also feel that I should smith. What? My dog has an obsession with you in general, my dear. My dear sweet Niecekin.
That's a problem.
It's a problem? Is it really a problem? No, I don't want to blow pop. Where did you get that? Where did that even come from?
I have my ways.
Oh, Lord. All right. Let's go ahead and do... I think we're going to do Blade Dance. Get 4 shifts instead of 3. You had 4 in your book bag? You have 3 more in your book bag? Brian, how are you doing there?
Oh,
your fur.
Oh, so, you know how I did the adaptive PE program, right? How I was working with special needs kids?
No, I did not know that. What?
I told you this earlier.
I swear you didn't.
I did.
I don't even know what to say at this point. Sorry, I didn't. I didn't realize.
But, so, because I do this program because I like helping people.
Yes.
And it's something I'm good at because I'm nice.
True. You is nice.
I've been doing it since, like, last year.
I didn't know that. That's great, Soph.
I signed up for it this year.
Uh-huh.
Because I wanted to do it. And we're having a dodgeball tournament on the 23rd of Friday.
That's very cool.
And, like, people outside of school, I think, can come see it, too.
Okay. Do you want me to come? Okay, I could do that.
And I'm on a team with the annoying kid that I don't like, which is going to be fun.
Okay.
No.
The mean girl? There's a mean girl? There's a mean girl. People are intimidated. I love you.
But the annoying kid that I dislike put me on his team with all of the kids that, like, I also help. And then another kid that annoys me, but, like, he's okay.
He's okay? Annoying. He's not that annoying?
I mean, yes, he aggravates me a lot.
But
he'll survive.
He'll survive.
And there's, like, I think up to 9 people on our team.
Okay.
And then tomorrow I have to do my, like, main mentor, like, the person that, like, I signed up for the Adaptive program to.
Yes.
I have to give her $10. $10 per, like, person that plays. Like, per teammate. And then it's, like, I think maybe $2 to get in.
Okay.
I'll have to look into it.
Interesting. Okay.
But that means I get to miss track practice.
Nice.
Or track practice is going to be canceled. And because of, like, all the dodgeball tournaments going on.
Ah, I see. Oh no, I'm going to die. Shoot. I should have done this differently. I should have used both bites and then I wouldn't have died. Oh well, I'll actually come back to life with slightly more health or maybe the same amount of health. No, I won't die! I forgot about Orichalcum again.
No, okay.
Orichalcum is a relic that I have that gives me 6 block when I don't have any block. If that makes sense. Jesus.
I don't want to do track on Tuesday.
You don't?
No
track on
Tuesday.
Okay.
Which, A, I'm upset about it, and B, I'm also happy about it. Because I'm nervous for track. But then, because track practice is going to go from 2:20 to like 4:50.
Boom, boom, boom. That's a while.
And then for our first few track meets, it's going to be at the middle school, and then we move to the high school.
Okay.
Which I don't really want to see my brother. Outside.
You're a goofball, you know that?
Yeah. You are too.
Yes. That's true. Nobody runs in our family. Ha ha! Guess funny.
you here. I love you too.
I'm always happy.
Okay, so the first one won't kill me, the second one will, but I won't have enough. So my only... I have to, though. I have to play this. It's still gonna kill me, I think. I think I'm dead. Let's see. 10, and then this will kill me. And I have 15 health left. Yeah, that's unfortunate. Damn! Alright, well... Alright, guys, I appreciate you all sticking with me. I think my wife will be home soon. Yes, my wife will be home soon from yoga, and we're going to watch some stuff and eat some food. So I got to go get that prepared, and I will talk to you guys all later. Thank you so much for being here. Bye, guys.